If you really believe in yourself, like I always have, keep at it. And I don't care if it takes 30, 40, 50 years, it will happen. And it'll make you happy.
Punk rock changed our lives.
Man that knows where he stands, who knows where he's going and where he's from. Can you feel it? The wind that takes it all. Oh, and you feel it? The wind that takes it all. Oh,
I said, hey, Sublime, Brad Nowell, yeah. that's the guy. Because he was just a super brilliant individual. I mean, you know, he is like a history book, just super intelligent with a worldview.
So when Brad got Louie, it was sort of happened by accident. Brad just heard about this guy who had a Dalmatian and he was working all the time. So he'd leave Louie in his bathroom, in his apartment. And Brad just thought that was horrible. He felt bad for the dog. And so he offered to buy him and the guy sold him to him. And from that moment on, they were inseparable. And I think because that was really the first time Brad had a pet that was solely his. You know, it wasn't the family pet. It was just his. And, you know, and so they just did everything together and went everywhere together. And I remember showing up to shows that they'd be doing at, you know, little dive bars. And if the club owner wouldn't let Louie inside, he would just be sitting there outside the door waiting for him. You know, Louie was just as dependent on Brad as Brad was on him, if not more so. I always say pets are like an extension of their owners. And that certainly was the case with Louie. he did get them into trouble.
At one point, Miles was driving Brad to gigs and stuff, like helping him out, drive his truck and stuff like that. And they helped us make our first record while we were still in high school. Bradley told Miguel, hey, go record these guys in this place called the Fake Nightclub. It's just a place in Long Beach, like a warehouse that they would record all their music. So while we were recording our very first record, they were recording their last record. I mean, just to be a kid in high school and to be able to make a record, you know, with your musical heroes. And then the guy who produced 40 Ounces of Freedom is producing your record. Those guys basically are, you know, they took us under their wing and told us it'll take 5 years from the time you guys start touring to actually even do anything. You guys got to put in the work on the road. They always told us, you have to put in the work on the road. If you don't put in the work on the road, it doesn't matter how many records you put out, how good your records are.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. You have to take your music to the road. So that's what we did in 96. We just hit the road. We've been doing it ever since.
When they were way on, there was no one with more talent and together than them at that point. And, you know, Brad Nowell, unfortunately we lost him. I always think about what he would have been doing. You know, he had so much talent that was just starting to be tapped by himself.
Into the middle of the track. He didn't hear the train coming, one clack, 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 clack. It wasn't him, it was a chop from the sky. It was straight to the ear and it went out through his backside.
We were on this mile high magic carpet ride, you know, and ascended. And then all of a sudden the carpet got ripped out from underneath us.
You know, pretty much every time I sit down on the drum kit, you know, it's just like always reminiscent, you know, man. Brother, I wish you were here. Definitely, when we're playing music and stuff, I can feel like a jab. I can still hear him saying, smack that snare drum like you thought up there.
He was a great guitar player. He was as good on guitar as he was a singer, and it wasn't fair he was so good. I can remember we'd be working on stuff, and Brad would be in the back working on lyrics, and whenever he was ready to do lyrics, we'd stop whatever we were doing, and he'd step up to the mic, and what that usually involved was he'd come in with his notepad and his pencil, and he'd get in front of the mic, And then we'd sit there for like 20 minutes with just silence. And I'd hear him breathing and scratching on his notepad. It was like, well, I thought he was ready, but I'm not going to say anything. And then he'd say, okay, and then hit record. And it was just always magic. You know, the guy was so spot on. All he needed was the lyrics, you know, and then he was just off to the races.
We play this festival with them called Fiddler on the Green outside of Denver. Super cool festival. We're on the small stage and we're doing our set and I'm singing a medley of English beat songs, Mirror in the Bathroom and Rankin Full Stop. I start chanting it off. I think Brad must have heard me and been like excited to do this particular song, but he just jumps on stage and grabs a microphone and starts singing it with me. It was totally fun. Like, it was the best. We're dancing around, singing together. And at some point, I look over at him and I look into his eyes and he's just like in outer space somewhere. We're singing the song and at some point he jumps down and just disappears into the crowd, just on his trip. Turns out that's the last time I ever saw Brad.